So remember, this lecture is supposed to be like 6 hours usually. I'm trying to do it in 40 minutes. So bear with me.
We keep it original.
Okay, original. Next time you can come to BGU. So I'm Michael, I'm an assistant professor at BGU. I have my own lab right now. I've been in the industry for a couple of years in the army. And this is the part that I'm explaining why is the change in big data and big data plus machine learning plus network science is the next big thing. So the first 20 minutes is going to be technical, so bear with me. After it, I try to give some cool examples. So let's start. So the world right now is really changing because of big data, data science, and all the other stuff. For me, I look at it at like three different changes from the last 10 years. First of all, we have open data. What is open data? When I started my PhD, I wanted a data set like Facebook or other data. It was really, really hard to get it. Like, for example, when I collect data from Facebook, it was okay back then. I need to develop my crawler, need to fight Facebook, and collect data. Today, I have everything for free. For example, this is from the city of Seattle, all the data of Seattle. You can dream what you want from street locations, traffic lights, everything. You can download online. Okay. I don't need Facebook anymore. This is the pushift.io. I can download Reddit data, the full Reddit data all the time. Other large-scale social networks are free, and everybody can download them. We have Kaggle. Kaggle is like the machine learning platform with competitions, but they also have a large data set. I think this is from last year. I don't know if you see it. It's like 12,000, where is it? 12,000 data sets. Today, I have more than 20,000 data sets. And we have list of open data sets. And this is from the sky, Gaia project. They collect information about the sky. From in physics, we have a lot of data everywhere, finally. If you want to do something in any domain, just go online, find your data sets, and try to analyze it. This is a list of notable data sets. What is important here, if you want a web data set, we have common crawl over several petabytes of data. You have YouTube videos. In our case, we're talking about networks. So in my website, we did a project. We have 1 terabyte of millions of networks, so you can use them. And everything is changing. And in these data sets, there's the next big thing.
Can you please, for just another second, the previous slide?
Okay, in the end, I will give you everything here, the data for good. Everything that I'm talking about, there's the lectures, the tutorials, there's papers on everything. Everything is open and you can just learn. Or do the Yandex school.
It's the same thing.
Okay, so we have a lot of data and you can do cool stuff with it. The second thing is data science tool. So if I'm coming back to analyze data today, I don't need to work really hard. It's like if you play Lego, in the beginning you have like small Lego bricks. Today you have like really black box that can do everything. So if I look at data and tools, we have everything in like how to store data from MongoDB, Spark, Neo4j. It's a lot of things, different technologies, but it's like make everything really easy. We have a lot of tools for machine learning, deep learning, PyTorch, TensorFlow, Weka, it's from 10 years ago. Visualization, we have all this upper part, D3, Altair, Vega, Vega Lite, endless opportunities to analyze, store, play with data, visualize data, do a lot of cool stuff. And we even have ways like Jupyter notebook to share data sets. So if you want to learn, just go online, you have everything. Really easy to access blocks. It's like really, really easy to learn. Again, 10 years ago, nothing. 8 years ago, maybe a lot of this stuff was really accessible, but it was hard to use. Okay, so open data, tools, and cloud infrastructure. Again, 8 years ago, when I needed a computer, maybe AWS was, I don't know, was existing, but if I need a supercomputer, I need a favor from friends, buy servers with tens of thousands of dollars. Today, you just go to one of these providers, and in $2 an hour, if you know to play the game and to rent a server, you can get a super server for $2 in the weekend. Like with hundreds of CPUs, 2 terabytes of RAM, and it's really nice, so you can do a lot of big data analysis. So this is the story about how the world changed. Now we're going to the story about what is good with networks. So we have graph and networks. Graph and networks are usually for mathematics, existing more than 100 years ago, I think 200 years ago. And we have a lot of networks and everything, not everything, almost everything, any complex system, you can present it as a graph or a network. Why it's good? In a few minutes, I explained it more, but if you have graph or networks, you can use a lot of tools to analyze the graph, extract feature, using tools from mathematics, from computer science, and it's make, if you want to extract data, it's really easy. I give a lot of example about it. So where are networks? So first of all, think about Facebook. Facebook is a social network. Each network is a person, is connected to other users in the network. We have computer networks, computer connected to each other. Financial transaction, Bitcoin is a network. Protein networks in biology, neural network in the brain. We have even social network in animals. And if each one of those examples, you have data online, can you play with it? So let's go to the question in Hebrew, it's tachles. So in order to play with the data, you need tools. There are a lot of different tools. Again, I need to point here. Okay, this is like the motivation. Motivation in here, meetup, we're going to explain what to do with networks and the tools. So there is a lot of network tools. If you use Python, usually I recommend one of three tools. NetworkX, it's a package. iGraph is also in R, and sGraph. Why is good and what is the bad, what the difference between the different package? So here are the cons and pro. So again, I talk about data. This is the tools that everybody can use, and it's really easy to use. NetworkX is a Python package. You can analyze networks with it. It's really easy, well documented. A lot of examples online. The problem with it is that it can only analyze small networks. Small networks, 10,000 of nodes. What is nodes? Nodes, there are two parts in networks. There is the vertices and links, or nodes and edges. The idea is the dots, like user profile is a vertex, or node, and the connection between vertices are links. This is the basic, if you want, think about Facebook all the time, think about, don't know what else, I'll give you some example in a few minutes. But the idea is you have like simple objects that are connected with each other. So coming back to NetworkX, NetworkX is using Python, a simple Python project, have a lot of options to use and analyze graphs, it's really easy to use. The problem is you can only work with really small graphs and it's really slow. Next we have iGraph. iGraph is, you can work with millions of vertices. Also, a lot of functionality, everything like NetworkX, but it's a little more complicated to understand. You can also use it in R, and you can work with datasets of millions of vertices and millions of edge. And if we go to the, this is less familiar, sGraph. I don't know how many of you heard about UriCreate, it's the Apple project for machine learning and data science. So in this project, you have sGraph. sGraph can support billions of vertices, billions of edges. It can analyze pretty much large part of the internet. The problem with it, it's like, it's also very efficient. The problem with it is that it's really, it's not hard to use, it, or even easy to use. It's, the problem is that you don't have a lot of functionality. So the idea is you can do simple stuff really quickly. If you want to do something more, you can use iGraph. If you're going to a master, grandmaster piece, you need to use sGraph. There are other package in the Apple packages in the internet online, but this is what I usually use. For actual example, if I want to use analyze like small networks, not like all Facebook, I use NetworkX. Large networks, pretty much all the time, is iGraph, and with sGraph, I analyze all of Reddit. It's like terabyte of data. Okay. Beside using tools to analyze graph, we also have a way to visualize graph. So this is how you visualize graph. It's not really good in this definition resolution. But you have Cytoscape. You can visualize graphs with tens of thousands of nodes. And we have Gephi. This is another project. You can also analyze tens of thousands of nodes. You need to choose what you want. It's pretty much, both of them are really, really easy to use. It's just a GUI if you want to play with graphs. And there's also D3 if you want to visualize something, network like this, dynamic network in your browser, use D3 or Sigma.js. And what is really important is all these packages are really, really well documented, each one of them. And you just can go to the code, everything is open sourced, and it's really fun to use. So this is the introduction. It's supposed to be like 3 hours with the code examples. Now we're going to the tachlis. So let's look an example of Marvel Universe. Okay, this is usually our large network our look. They work harder to create it. You can use online. This is a website from Marvel Universe. The idea is this is the vertex link, and we have all the other superheroes with connection. And we can play with them. We can look, for example, visualization about Iron Man. You can take subgraphs or heroes, if I have online. And you can play with the networks. You can't see it really good because of the resolution, but it's really fun. And this is how usually networks appear. So this is for fun in the browser. But this is the idea of networks. And let's say I want to analyze Marvel Hero Universe. So I take, this is not a really big network. I'm going to Kaggle and download the network. And using NetworkX, I can visualize it, or at least part of the network. This is only two free line of code. You can go to my website with the tutorial to do it. And you can see who is friend of whom. You can see that there is something in the middle. It's like very centrality, central figure. In this case, I think it's Captain America. And you can learn something interesting about the network only by drawing it. But the fun starts more. Because I told you, network and graph theory exist for a long, long time. So I can use this type of object and extract information on each dot on each, or each line automatically. It's like only a few lines of code. For example, I can understand how many friends this user have. How many friends this user have. What is the probability that this link and this user will be friends in the future? Everything is ready for you. Any questions before we go into the hardcore? Okay, so we have a lot of different features that you can extract on each vertex or each link. For example, they decrease the number of friends, custom coefficient, how well the friends are grouped, between the centrality, how much central is each vertex or each link in the graph, and there is endless a number of features you can extract on each vertex or each link. There are tens of thousands of academic papers about this issue. And different measures and what they are good for or not bad for. And what is really cool about it is that if you go to NetworkX, iGraph, or other packages, you just have a graph object and choose your vertex or link and start to extract feature. I will show you it in a few minutes. But the idea with a lot of things that people did before us that can extract information about the network. And we can also use different type of algorithms to analyze the network. For example, we can do a community detection. It's like split the network to different communities automatically. We can do a shortest path. If you, for example, you can present street as a graph, and you want to find a way to get from A to B, there's pretty much, somebody did it before, it's only using a function in the graph. With PageRank, PageRank is how Google used ranked pages in the past, according to the number of incoming links to a page. And again, we have endless. This is only small, very small subset. The idea is, using each one of them on a graph, it's a line of code, usually. So in one line of code, I make a data set and a network. Then I can analyze the network using different algorithms and extract different features. So let's start with a simple problem. I'm in Facebook. I want to find new friends. This is how I started in 2012. I started my PhD with this idea, doing green prediction. Green prediction can help you do a lot of stuff. Recommending friends on Facebook, recommending new items, creating a recommendation system. If you look at terrorist networks, you can find hidden connections. This is really useful. And also Facebook did a competition in Kaggle that would do the best link prediction algorithm, get a job interview. So it's really useful for a lot of stuff, from finding terrorists to getting a job. And I don't know if you see the resolution. So if you want to do a simple link prediction, it's a few lines of code. The idea, I want to find new friends. So I need to find other people that have mutual friends with me that are not my friends. So, for example, in one of the crowd, if I'm looking in the crowd, at everybody of you, I can find all of my mutual friends and find the person here that have the most mutual friend with me, common friend. So I don't know if you see it, it's like, finding if I have a graph object G in network case and U of V two users in the graph, for example, in this line of code, I can find the number of common friends. So if I'm taking, for example, the the friends that come, common friends for Spider-Man and Green Goblin, this is the list, is only 3 lines of code. It's really simple. But let's move forward. I want to find new friends for a person. So I can do, how can I do it? I look, this is the simple idea. Again, this is like few lines. The idea is to find, create a simple solution. The idea is I look at all my friends, I look at all my friends' friends, and find all the friends' friends that are not my friends, sorry about it, that we have a lot of common friends in common. Everybody with me? Again, the hour is late. So again, if I want to find new friends, I need to go more to my friends, find their friends that are not my friends, and somehow rank them. How I rank them? Each one of my friends' friends that is not a common, it's not my friend, I need to find the number of common friends with him. So this is the code for this algorithm, and you can see that, for example, for Ant-Man, I want to find new friends to Ant-Man. You find what I told you before, it's like a few lines of code. Scan all my friends' friends, calculate the number of common friends with my friends' friends, and order them. And this idea works pretty well. But this is really simple. Let's move to the next level. Everything, again, everything here, you can read the tutorials, the code examples. People are like doing it for a lot of years. I myself have several papers about it. So it's really easy. It's a really good place to start. The next thing is let's go to machine learning. So I'm going to explain about supervised learning too much. The idea is that if I want to predict links or predict something using supervised learning, I need good examples and bad examples. It's like good example, links that exist. Bad example, links that don't, doesn't exist. And when for each link that exists or doesn't exist, I need to get features. Generate features. So how I generate features, again, it's really easy because I have graph. I take Spider-Man, for example, and Green Goblin. I can have a link between them. It exists. This is one example. I need to extract a lot of feature. Ken, yes.
So, is this the same problem in all the balance? If you have too many bad samples?
No, it's not imbalance. There is an imbalance. This is like really advanced. Yes, in practical, most of the links not exist, but there are different problems. If you want to predict future friends, it's one problem. If you want to predict missing friends, it's something else. But generally, this works, but it's like really deep. This is like extra advanced. So take me the idea. The idea is like explaining what to do. So I have like two users, and I can create a lot of links that exist, a lot of links that doesn't exist. I need a lot of examples. I don't know if you can see it, but not this example again. Okay, so it's like the problem with the presentation. The problem is that I can create a lot of generate a lot of links, bad and good links, and using really simple function network X. I can create a lot of features. This is, for example, 8 features about the grid, the number of friends, the number of friends each one of us has. And totally, you can see it's like we have 20,000 links, 10,000 of them exist, 10,000 doesn't exist. And this is like really simple. It takes only a few hours to create this type of classifier. You create a classifier from it. You can see that even with a simple solution, you can get pretty decent predictor, classifier to predict missing links. If you measure there, you see it's 0.998. If you want to do something better or something with imbalance, this is a different story. But again, people do it in Kaggle and in competitions. Some people are even extract hundreds of features. Again, you can extract a lot of features, just need to merge them because everything is ready in the package of NetworkX or iGraph.
It depends on your network.
So it's really easy. So this is the idea. You have data. You can create the data to network, you can use different tools, extract feature, and use machine learning. With this method, you can solve a lot of different problems. For example, I wanted to predict in my class the final exam score of my students. So how you predict the final exam score of your students? This is a big problem. You can analyze NLP about the homework, you can do a lot of different stuff. What I did was create a network of the class. People are connected with each other. This is an actual network. People are connected to each other if they submitted the homework together, if they use the same user IP, if they try to cheat together, and so on. So then you get the network again. And if you look at the network and the final score, you can see that you can, the people are, have similar, similar final exam to their friend score. So for example, you can see that this guy got 86.7 and his friend is not very, really far behind. And you can use machine learning to predict and then regression. And this is a nice idea. Again, we started from predicting student score, use data, create a graph using machine learning, we have a solution. Different problem, we try to predict fake profiles in Facebook, social boots, it's like fake news. How you can identify fake news or fake profiles? Someone have an idea? Like in, it's a really simple way.
They don't have many posts. They
have a lot of posts.
They don't have friends and their friends are not connected between themselves.
This is a good idea. Yeah, this is good, but still, what are you doing? This, maybe 10 years ago you can succeed. The idea is that social fake profiles don't have friends and the friends don't connect to each other. How you solve it? They create 100 fake profiles, connect with themselves, connect to each other, and try to disappear themselves in the crowd. And it worked. So the idea was differently. The first idea is like really simple. Let's take the graph, split it to communities, and we split the graph to communities. Regular users, like for example myself, in Facebook, I am friends from friends from high school, friends from my friends in the army, and so on. But fake profile choose their victim randomly. So they're connected to a lot of different friends, different communities. Again, the community is like taking the graph, split it to communities. This is a, somebody did it before. It's like one line of code, takes some time. Counting the number of communities is another few lines of code. And in the end, doing this, this is work pretty good. The problem is somebody have an idea what the problem with this algorithm, why it doesn't really work that good? The problem is like Britney Spears or Donald Trump. They also have a lot of communities friends because they are celebrities. So celebrities are ruining this algorithm and people that are seeking for dates. So this is the problem. So we need to do something else. So the other thing, the second thing you can do is if you remember the link prediction algorithm, I can take each link and predict the probability that the link exists. Again, with machine learning gives me probability if someone is one or zero, if the link exists or not. And what we discovered that a lot of fake profiles have a lot of fake links because the link doesn't need to be exist. And this works on pretty much a lot of solutions, not only social boots, this is like a new paper. It works on communities, detecting outliers, and so on in general graph. But the idea is, like, again, taking a graph, finding something interesting, extracting a feature, and doing machine learning. The same method, coming back, same method did a link prediction, the same idea. Do exam scores, find fake profiles, and next, predicting lifespan. This is another problem. I want to predict the lifespan of people. So how can I do it? Somebody have an idea? For seeing the others. If I want to predict if somebody is the age of 60, if he's going to live until the age of 80. Why can't you do it with the graphs and networks?
Your friends will live up to 100.
This is a nice idea. So again, I give you the solution. So this is like Adam and Eve, Adam and Chava, the network. Everybody's part of network, but dead people networks in this case. And in recent years, we have a lot of networks like MyHeritage, WikiTree that have a lot of data about people that live in the past. So in this case, in Albert Einstein, this is WikiTree, it's open and free. And the shared, after we did something, we called the network and asked them to make it public, and they make it public in the end. So you have all the data free for research, and you can see the Albert Einstein, who is our son, who is his brother's husband, and you have the network of people that live in the past, and you also have his lifespan. So, again, open data. You have millions of profiles of, I think, 17 million. In MyHeritage, you have 2 billion. But this is open. You get a lot of information about people that live in the past. And you can do different statistics. This is how lifespan change over time. You can do crazy stuff with it, like predict what is the common name and how it changed. You can discover that every time that somebody became a president, his name became popular. And so on. And if we come back to, you can find lifespan in different states in the United States. And you can create a graph. This is with cytoscape. This is only a small part of the graph, about 20,000 people. he said that family trees are not really family trees, like giant air ball. But using this idea, I can, using graphs, I can find the lifespan of siblings, parents, and so on, and we can create, again, extract free features. Using free features, I can create a model that can predict lifespan. And it worked pretty much, and I think this is the last example, before last example. So also, human lifespan, it also worked. Another question we want to ask, ask ourselves is, I want to analyze networks, organization. How can I analyze organization? The idea is if I add all of LinkedIn, I can understand how company change over time. This was, I think, 2014. Still, before Cambridge Analytica, what we did, we analyzed crawl Facebook, collect information about people, and created a company's networks. This is, for example, a company. Each dot is an employee of the company. I don't know if you can see that there are triangles. Triangles are managers in the company. So what are the colors? The color is taking the graph. Creating the graph is one thing. This is for open data. The colors is community detection. And if you can see the community detection, the community detection actually help us to understand how the company works. And you can see that blue and orange are RD division, red nodes are senior management. And I have a lot of examples how to do it. And it's crazy. For example, we discovered that one company bought another company, and the other company, only the manager become friends, and the other company is like standalone. And this is only by calling it on Facebook, creating a graph, analyze it, automatically analyze it. And if, again, if you want machine learning, we can use machine learning to predict people that are in leadership roles, even if they try to hide it. For example, we had a company in Japan that all the senior VP didn't vote in the Facebook that are senior VP, but using centrality measure and machine learning, again, extracting the automatic feature, we succeeded to discover it in pretty decent accuracy. So again, different problem, same method. It's repeating itself all the time. Take the data, present this graph, use a lot of feature extraction, do some machine learning, and you have something, some nice insights. Last example is something completely different, gender inequality in movie industry. So we talk about graph, but we can work with a lot of different networks or graph. In this case, what we did, this is from this year, we took subtitles. We do an NLP, we analyze the subtitles in the movie, extract people that work, that connected to each other in the same scene or near scenes, and create a network of the movie. Again, it's like different. We took NLP, we create a network. This is the bottom line, and validate the network with data for IMDb. Everything is open, by the way, you can see our code, everything is totally open. And using this, we created movies, like networks of 40,000 movies. So we have subtitles, IMDb, created movies. And this is an example for Star Wars movies. And we wanted to see how women portraits change over time, if they have a lot of gender equality, inequality. And it's like pretty imaging. There is great inequality in the movie industry. But the idea is you can see it in this is Star Wars movies. In the beginning, we have only one female. And as time go by, in the end, we have more equity. And you can see that with time, females get more central roles. So in this case, what I need to take home is that you can create from text networks, can take a lot of networks, analyze them, create information over time, and do something cool with it. In this case, there's something they call Bechdel test to measure inequality in movies, and you use machine learning and graph theory to predict if a movie passed the Bechdel test. This is a totally different story, but the same idea. Take a graph, use machine learning, do something interesting with it. This is the end. If you want everything, all the tutorials, code, papers, everything is free available. We try to make our papers accessible, dataforgood.io. And that's it. Any questions? Yes.
Did you try to compare the amount of data that you need for graph-based prediction versus the traditional method?
No, but in the link prediction problem, we try to predict how many links we need, how many examples we need to get the optimal classifier. And it's like, you don't need too many examples because everything is like in clustering specific communities, everything is pretty much the same. But the general examples of what we tested. But you can do it, it's supposed to be interesting. Yeah, of course. Yeah, but this is like, I do it because it's easier for me. This is my tool. Other questions? Okay, thank you.